Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Crow Cycle 3 by Dem Mikhailov, translated by Vera Klink, narrated by Roman Howell. Chapter 1. The Calm Within the Storm, a Temporary Break. The anvil was ringing. The rapid staccato of the forging hammer echoed happily to the furthest reaches, soaring over the gray stony plain, bending around the sparse crooked trees, and flying into the twitching ears of jackals and rabbits. The ringing of the anvil signified a lot. For example, it meant that the Gray Peak outpost had survived the recent invasion of enemies, gray orcs, who, acting on the orders of the dark and terrifying four-armed goddess Guara, had unearthed the Sword of War and descended from the mountains to exterminate all living beings. And right now, the ringing anvil was like a triumphantly singing bell that proclaimed important news. The outpost was still standing. Gray Peak was alive. Also, the ringing boldly stated that a certain blacksmith had enough strength left in his arms and enough stubbornness in his head in order to start smithing literally right after the conclusion of the latest hard battle. The column of dark gray smoke rising over the large hill, surrounded by a stone wall, indicated that the forge was fired up to the maximum. Additionally, the ringing of the hammer told everyone within earshot that the outpost was not timidly hiding in a corner. Not in the slightest. Gray Peak was not afraid to make lots of noise. It was not afraid to ring loudly. The outpost continued to exist like nothing particularly bad had happened. So what if it got attacked by a few hundred dark gill midgets, plus some monstrous ricefin insects, as well as the malicious giant gray orcs commanding them? Not a problem. So what if they had to deal with the gigantic butterfly Drughone, born of the magic of Guara's temple, the one whose foul body blocked out the sun and skies, the one accompanied by thick black storm clouds pierced by furious bolts of forked lightning? Piece of cake! The anvil's ringing paused for a moment. The jackals lying on the strangely sloped side of the hill perked up their ears hopefully, but their happiness was short-lived. After the sound of furious hissing as red-hot metal touched cold water, the hammer resumed its joyful song. The stony plain around Gray Peak had changed dramatically within a single day. The raging battle had left numerous heavy wounds and scars on the surface of the earth. But Waldira wasn't a magical world for nothing. The plain was rapidly returning to its original state. The deep furrows in the ground were vanishing. The coarse grass that had been torn off the hillside had returned in the form of fresh green shoots. The trampled bird nests were once again hidden by the roots of a stout prickly shrub, which had shed its broken branches and grown back new ones. Even the stones that had been pulverized into dust had magically returned to their places. Heavy foreign objects, huge dark boulders for instance, were slowly sinking into the ground as if being sucked into quicksand. Trios of guards marched purposefully around the outpost. They kept alert, vigilantly looking around, holding spears and crossbows at the ready, and covering their backs with heavy full-sized shields. From beneath one of the shrubs, two shapes darted out with a frightened squeal, a cringing gill midget and a mangy jackal. They had been waiting together for the danger to pass, but couldn't take it anymore, and bolted. They got immediately hit by two crossbow bolts, followed by three arrows from the watchtower. Both enemies died instantly. The guards continued patrolling, while also picking up the remains of equipment and weaponry left behind by enemies that had died or fled. Every other step the guards took was accompanied by the sound of the ringing anvil. The territory of the outpost was abuzz with activity. Some of the muscular warriors had put away their weapons, taken off their armor, and, with their comrades watching their backs, began to clean up. Like a broom in the hands of a skillful housewife, they left nothing behind except clean, compacted soil. After only 2 hours, the outpost of Gray Peak sparkled with cleanliness. Large sheets of canvas were spread on the ground, bearing two huge piles of war trophies. the plunder will be divided up by nightfall. Most of it will be sent to Algora with the next convoy. The rest will be given to a certain brave black-haired dwarf, who, along with his foreigner friends, had taken active participation in the defense of the outpost. The dwarf, by the way, was a remarkable individual. It was him who was swinging the forging hammer, creating the happy ringing from the vibrating anvil. He could have given himself over to well-earned idleness. He could be sitting back and sipping dark beer from Abel and Gabber right now. Nonetheless, he got to work instead. What was more, he was working harder than the disciplined and focused guards. Even the dwarf's laborers, whom he had kept from participating in the recent fight, were working as hard as they could. Like the guards patrolling the perimeter of the outpost, they walked around collecting stones and chopping trees. They dragged the materials back to the hill and left them by the only opening in the wall, which was destined to become a secure gate in the future. The gatherers of construction materials were accompanied by a sauntering red-haired girl named Laura Lena. She was armed with a pair of unusually thick daggers, which, by their look, were capable of disemboweling even a swamp croco-goat, which inhabited scary underground sloughs in abandoned and flooded mines of slag mountains. Although the girl was strolling at a leisurely pace, her sharp gaze could indicate a lot to an experienced fighter. This fragile-looking young lady was perfectly capable of defending several workers from local dangers. The stones that had been left near the opening in the wall were taken inside by a regularly appearing and disappearing dwarf, whose face was smeared with mortar. As soon as one of these stones ended up in his skillful hands, it would instantly take its place in the steadily growing stone wall. The master of the land plot, officially known as Crow Eater, or simply Crow, was determined to turn his property into a most securely defended fort. In order to achieve his goal, he spared no effort, neither his own nor other people's. Clasped in blackened tongs, a red-hot ingot plunged into the water and with malicious hissing choked on the rushing steam. Next moment, it clinked into place, side by side with its brethren inside a large and sturdy wooden chest. The amount of ingots kept steadily increasing. The dwarf Crow was absolutely determined to reforge into ingots all of his metal junk, which, until recently, had belonged to the gill midgets. Nothing could shake his determination. His self-improvement was behind schedule, which he had so carefully planned ahead of time and confirmed by himself. It was as if Waldira itself had turned against his innocent plans. Helping friends, fighting enemies, running into problems with the new guards, fending off gray orcs, all these incidents, big and small, continually forced him to step away from his main goal. That was unacceptable. He must become a real master blacksmith. And even that was just a small step in a nearly infinite steep ladder that reached up to the dark, impenetrable clouds of the legendary art of blacksmithing. That's why, regardless of whether they were in a state of war or not, the player will stubbornly reforge junk into heavy ingots. Then he'll put them to use before dinner time, turning the reforged metal into objects fit for sale, nails, horseshoes, and iron axles. Right now, the player was becoming increasingly aware of the huge benefits of having an ally that he could trust as much as himself. Lori, that red-headed unruly catastrophe, who had magically returned to his side, was quite fiery, extremely experienced, and possessed a ridiculously large stash of important gaming knowledge. She knew how to act even in the most unusual situations. This meant that right now, Crow's workers were being escorted by a real Jedi who had swapped his lightsaber for a pair of daggers. That's why Crow could now focus on his work without worrying about his men. He didn't need to keep glancing over the wall, afraid of seeing the poor laborers getting devoured by jackals or prodded with spears by orcs. There was a danger that the extremely self-assured Lori might think she is capable of handling any sort of trouble on her own and decide not to inform Crow. The dwarf was prepared for this eventuality. Over the rocky wasteland soared a huge eagle with outstretched wings, his eyes looking disdainfully at the world slowly passing below him. The eagle, Chris, was sent to patrol and hunt. After spotting worthy prey, a large jackal, a particularly fat partridge, or a carnivorous nepenthesis plant, Chris would shoot down from the skies like a bullet, delivering a mighty blow. Then, if the enemy had not been defeated, he would seize it in his talons and soar up into the heavens, where he would mercifully release it and watch it freefall. That's why, in the last half hour, Crow had already witnessed three flying jackals, who squealed pitifully as they fell to the ground. It was convenient. All he had to do was look up, and he would immediately see the large bird ruling the skies over the wasteland beside the granite mountain peak. The workers were watched by Lori. The red-headed Amazon was watched by Chris. The eagle was watched by Crow. And the dwarf was watched by Centurion Vurius, who kept appearing in Crow's line of sight. What an interesting chain of connections. And it could be continued until it came around full circle. Vurius was watched by his loyal guards, and the guards were watched by Crow's workers, who knew that it was precisely these wise and experienced warriors who would be likely to spot the first signs of trouble. But why complicate things? It was already obvious that everything and everyone at the outpost was inextricably connected, which was perfectly normal for such a small settlement. As for Myth and Amau, they were true friends, as Crow had come to think of them lately. They were a crazy pair who loved adventures, mysteries, and puzzles. That was exactly how real gamers should be. Most importantly, Amau and Myth knew how to trust, how to learn new things, and how to forget useless old knowledge without clinging to it with inexplicable stubbornness. Only players with these types of qualities had the potential of turning into new gaming legends who would be talked about with awe for many years to come. The girl bard and the card master had all the makings of future stars, but Crow didn't tell them this in order to avoid spoiling them with praise and cause them to become overconfident. Right now, his friends had gone back to the real world to sleep. They will return a little later to attend the late dinner hosted by the guards in celebration of their successful defense against enemy invasion. For the first time since arriving at the Gray Peak outpost, Centurion Vurius, the mysterious muscular giant, had invited the players to a modest feast. This was despite the fact that Centurion Vurius treated their kind, players, or so-called foreigners, with a strange kind of mistrustful harshness, if not outright hatred. Thus, even the smallest thawing in relations with him can and should be considered a huge step forward. Crow must do everything in his power not to break this fragile little bridge of peace that had been built between two formerly antagonistic sides. The anvil was ringing, the forging hammer was singing, the frequent rhythmic sound carried far and wide, declaring loudly and confidently, "The outpost of Gray Peak is alive and will keep on living." Neither Gray Orcs, nor Gill Midgets, nor Nepenthes, or Ricefins, nor Drughone the Destroyer, not even the gray-skinned goddess Guara, who commands them all, were able to crush the outpost. While his sinewy arms worked deftly on their own, the wise head of the busy dwarf was lost in deep thought. Like Lori, the dwarf possessed a huge amount of knowledge, had been on the most incredible adventures, had seen hundreds of sudden unforeseen outcomes and gritty conclusions to fights. The dwarf understood that the tightening spiral of the growing war around Gray Peak will change, and has already changed many things. It was like the appearance of a large poisonous snake. Until it slithers away by itself or gets chased off, peace will not return to the surrounding inhabitants. The dwarf had no power to stop the war. Negotiation will not work with Gray Orcs. That's why the war will continue right to the point where one of the conflicting sides gets utterly destroyed. Until then, the tiny outpost in the middle of the boring rocky plain will be like a grain of sand between two mighty grinding stones of war. That's why he must do everything in his power to prevent that grain of sand from being ground fatally into dust. He would need to use all of his strength and resources to save the outpost. To do so, he would have to completely rearrange his former routine, which he had established over the past few weeks. Carefully, he lowered another smoking iron ingot into the wooden chest. Something clicked inside the dwarf's head, and he came to a decision. From now on, Crow will no longer concern himself with the gathering of food and resources. Gone are the days when the dwarf, humming a carefree tune under his breath, would run around in the valley, chopping trees, picking up rocks, gathering eggs, tearing out bunches of wild onions, and hunting rabbits. These matters will be delegated entirely to his workers. If necessary, their numbers will be increased. For now, though, while everything around him is consumed by the chaos of a recently started war, he will have to hold off on hiring new hands and try to manage with the workers he already has. However, the dwarf will no longer be able to go hunting for bird eggs himself, not until more peaceful and predictable days return. Clang! Another dully glittering ingot fell into the chest. From now on, Crow will no longer stand behind the sales table. No more personal involvement in the happy chaos of trade. Someone else will have to do it instead. He will have to hire a trustworthy salesman from a merchant guild. A beginner merchant apprentice with great ambitions will suffice. The dwarf himself will hang around as much as possible while keeping an ear out, not because he doesn't trust the salesman, but because he doesn't want to miss the opportunity to make a potentially interesting deal. That would be the only time he might interfere. Just in case, he will also handle all sales of his personally crafted iron objects, the assortment of which he planned to substantially increase in the nearest future. The forging bellows sighed heavily, pushing air towards the glowing coals. The tongs seized a red-hot twisted breastplate and threw it onto the anvil. Forging and digging. Those are the two activities to which he should dedicate half of his waking hours, working hard with a shovel and hammer. He didn't really need full mastery of the art of digging, although the indirect benefits from being able to work quickly with a shovel were quite palpable, so he should develop those skills. The Guild of Miners awaited him. The art of blacksmithing, on the other hand, was a much more painful subject. He would have to work really hard to catch up. With a hiss, an ingot dropped into the chest. Two more objects dropped into the fire, both crudely made items of orc gear. The other half of his time should be devoted to war and diplomacy. Orcs and other vermin should be destroyed. The walls around his home must be strengthened. His possessions and influence around here should be gradually increased. Everything else will be handled by his friends and hired workers.
A convoy! It's damaged and smoking!
The loud calling voice of the watchman carried the important news to the black-haired dwarf's ears. The dwarf perked up, turning his face in the direction of Lori, who walked like a shepherd behind the heavily laden workers. A moment later, Chris dropped down onto his shoulder, bringing the same news. For now, the young eagle's eyes were no match for the powerfully enchanted spyglass possessed by the guards, but that will change soon. If Crow trains his pet correctly, he can achieve a sharp improvement in the bird's skills as an aerial observer.
"Zap! We need to sell them stuff!"
exclaimed the red-haired Amazon as she rushed up to the dwarf.
"Are we going to start selling? We have eggs and meat, and loads of other things. Look at how much delicious stuff Grubber has cooked up."
"We need to start selling, yes," nodded Crow. "But I can't do it myself anymore. We'll have to hire a merchant. Meanwhile, I'm entrusting it to you, darling."
"Fine, I'll be at the market stand. But the workers will have to sit in the yard for now. Outside the outpost, we have run into a bunch of Nepenthes 3 times already. We've even stumbled upon an orc survivor hiding under a pile of earth. I'll find something for them to do. Did you remove the landmines?"
The dwarf nodded, squeezing the bellows to fan the flame.
The yard is clean. I've put everything away into the hiding place inside the tomb. When are we going to sit down together to discuss hot gossip concerning Virius? I'd prefer after dinner.
I wasn't invited to your dinner with the guards, the girl reminded him.
Such is the fate of spies, to remain in the shadows.
The player smiled.
No matter, we'll feed you here. I'll only stay there for a little while, drink a couple of cups, and go straight home.
I need to keep forging and digging. Forging and digging.
Is His Excellency, our blue-eyed leader, planning to show up soon?
Asked Lori, easily lifting a wooden chest filled with tableware.
I haven't seen him for quite some time.
We won't see him for a while yet,
answered the dwarf.
He is down south. As far as I know him, he is likely to be hosting the most delicious dinners for himself every single day, drinking good wine, reading excellent books, and shocking everyone around him with his incredible royal extravagance.
For sure, said Lori, nodding vigorously. That's how he is, as I remember in the old days.
In the coming days, things will be even more interesting, said Crow with another smile, grabbing a hammer. Go sell stuff, earn us some money, but first, go feed our people.
Zap, judging by the fire in your nearsighted little dwarvish eyes, are you thinking of bringing back the epic times? Or, as you stated it so grandly, things will be even more interesting in the new world? Are we going to become a legend again? A new great legend?
Judging by the girl's face, she was more than just curious. The answer was truly important to her. Lying would be unacceptable. That's why the dwarf told her the honest truth, lifting his head and looking her directly in the eye.
Give us some time, and we'll become it. A new great legend.
Yes! Cried Lori, stomping her foot. Yes, I can't wait for epicness.
But I'll be the coolest one,
added Crow, turning back to reforging metal junk.
Hell no, Zap! The only thing cooler than me will be the icebergs. And even then, it'll be me who'll be sitting atop of their proud peaks. Hell yeah, I'm off to sell stuff. By the way, I'll be taking some of the money. For various female needs of a dagger-wielding assassin. You know, a few things here, a few things there.
All right, grumbled the dwarf.
Take it. You know moderation. And another thing, start working on a Mao and myth. I think they're suitable.
Yes, they are, said Lori, nodding confidently as she lifted an overturned wooden table off the ground.
Surprisingly suitable. Right now, they're still cute little kittens enamored by Waldira. But if you cut away a couple large chunks of their excessive inner kindness, if you send them on enough grim but terribly interesting missions, then they'll turn into excellent fighters.
You do that, concluded Crow, looking over a slightly reduced pile of trophy junk.
Catch them before the invitational dinner and tell them exactly how to behave during these kinds of events.
Right. After that, I'll be off to Algora for an hour, and then I'll be off to attend to another matter. I won't be home until late, dear. Don't lock the door, and don't wrap yourself in the blanket, so I won't have to wake you up and unravel you by kicking.
Hang on, when are we going to talk about Virius?
Later,
said the Amazon, shrugging. She planted the market table squarely in the wall opening, blocking the entrance.
I'm gathering intel.
I won't get in your way, then. Are you going to have to travel on foot?
Yeah, I'll have to walk for a bit.
Just don't kill anyone, dear,
said Crow, widening his eyes in mock fear. Then he laughed out loud and said, Find me an old merchant with an apprentice. Promise them food, protection, comfortable living quarters, fair wages, beer, and other refreshments. By the way, regarding beer, try to bring back as many provisions as you can. And several very simple but very interesting culinary recipes. I want to give them as a small present to Grubber, but make sure the recipes have a touch of spicy or even a tropical note. And they can't require more than the common ingredients, like beef, flour, and black pepper. And also,
Oi, oi, protested the girl. Slow down. I'm off to gather information, remember? Well, maybe to kill a monster or two. And you've assigned me a bunch of tasks. No way, forget it. Getting recipes and a few provisions from the other outposts on my way, fine, but nothing more. Tsk, pouted the player resentfully. Don't tsk at me, Zap. Fine, sighed Crow. Provisions, recipes, and information. The convoy's almost here. Bring out those heavy boxes, my delicate one.
Encouraged by the news, Lori hustled across the yard at triple speed. Thankfully, her strength and agility allowed for these kinds of feats. As the girl moved, she managed to avoid hitting anyone in the household, whether dogs or people, who were busy with work or just lying around lazily in the afternoon sun. The inner yard had only been partially cleaned up. The workers were getting ready for dinner, after which they would be going to bed. The hired old warrior sat on a tall chair on the slope of the hill, glancing warily at the skies and into the distance. The veteran remembered the malicious, ugly harpies, those messengers and personal servants of the dark goddess Guara. Those winged beasts could attack so suddenly you'd be dead before you know it. In the nearest future, Crow would need to hire another warrior archer and one tank who would be able to withstand an enemy below without dying. First of all, though, he needed to expand the underground living quarters and finish them properly. Speaking of finishing, he needed another dwarf for that. Another skilled stonemason, but with a slightly different and more magical specialization. The level of a skilled apprentice would be suitable.
Crow knew where to find someone like that.
The only thing left was to find out when he would have enough time to run an errand of this kind.
So many things to do. But wasn't that the beauty of life?
The loud clang of a metal gong came from the tower. Its sound, calm and peaceful, announced the upcoming dinner, which was in less than half an hour. That was the cook's way of saying that he did not wish for the food he had prepared to get cold. The guards at the outpost noticeably perked up, smiled, and began to talk louder amongst themselves. Right now, they were no different from real people, just regular soldiers who'd been fighting all day, then dragging back corpses and trophies. Obviously, they had worked up a serious appetite. Just in time for a hearty dinner, how could they not be overjoyed? Simple and worthy desires must always be satisfied. The dwarf hammered away faster. He was slightly behind schedule. He still had to forge another 3 or 4 ingots before dinner, wash himself, comb his hair, put on clean clothes, and not be the last to arrive at the guard's dining table. When Centurion Vurius enters the dining room, Crow, Myth, and Amau must already be there.
We're here! Did you miss us? Crowsy! Lori! The heroes are back!
The instant flash of teleport left behind a happily prancing couple on the grass.
Oxen! Behind you!
Shouted Lori hurriedly, her hand pointing at a danger the two friends hadn't noticed. The pair turned around and hastily jumped out of the way. They had been nearly trampled by 2 large bulls, who had bent their massive horned heads to the ground and were heavily stepping forward as they dragged an overloaded smoking cart behind them.
We need to teach them to look around as soon as they exit the teleport, muttered Crow ruefully. Optimistic greenhorns, careless fools.
The fools had successfully avoided a collision with the large horned bovines. They dashed off to meet Lori, having quickly realized that it was her who needed help, whereas Crow could manage on his own. The dwarf threw the final portion of scrap metal onto the coals and stared at the convoy as it slowly moved into the territory of the outpost. The carts bore marks of an enemy attack. Some of the oxen were missing. Ripped harnesses dragged along the ground. Many wheels were burnt, wobbling, and smoking. The canvas cloth covering the load was ripped in many places. In some spots, it was torn into long, thin shreds, as if a sharp-clawed tiger had skidded across them. A tiger or a smilodon? The saber-toothed cats of the gray orcs were perfectly capable of leaving such tracks with their claws. As for the other rips and tears, Those were the damages from harpies who dropped out of the skies like dive bombers. But the convoy survived, which means that it ran into a tiny scouting squad, a couple of Smilodon riders and a couple of harpies. The convoy men were in a pitiful state. Fortunately, they will be able to acquire food, firewood, and other provisions from Lori. In addition, the dwarf had several suitable wheels and axles for them. He could even find a few horseshoes. Crow's prediction came true in its entirety. Worn out by the road and the fighting, the convoy men spotted the market stand. As soon as they had parked their carts, many of the guys rushed over to the saleswoman, who was smiling seductively as she juggled 3 partridge eggs and 2 horseshoes at the same time. The men fixed their hungry gazes on the objects flashing through the air. Crow hadn't thought of advertising his services that way. Snorting resentfully, he hammered away, hastening to fulfill his production quota.
How should one behave during dinner with Centurion Vurius?
The answer is quite simple. Sit quietly, don't talk, don't eat too much, pay attention to what is being said, don't yell out weird battle cries, don't praise anyone, don't criticize anyone. In other words, just sit there and eat in silence. And listen carefully. Don't do anything else. Those were the instructions that the dwarf gave to Amau and Myth, and that is exactly what the wise dwarf did himself. Naturally, they were seated at the very end of the table, far from the mighty and brave Centurion Vurius. He sat so imperiously and looked around so sternly that he immediately brought to mind great rulers from ancient times, such as Alexander the Great and Tamerlane. The Centurion's influence was smaller in scale, and he had far fewer soldiers under his command. Still, he looked quite impressive. There was plenty of food. No fancy caviar or shrimps in honey sauce.
However, simple and tasty dishes were in abundance. Meat soup with seconds available, pasta with meat sauce, meat pies, cherry jam.
It was specifically the jam that impressed Crow to the depths of his soul, turning out to be absolutely delicious. Therefore, the dwarf quietly kept spreading one piece of toast after another with the jam, taking the opportunity to eat as much as he can. The centurion's kindness was fickle. He'll invite you to dinner today, but chase you off tomorrow. At the table, Vurius's voice serenaded them all as they ate. While partaking in the food, the centurion's raspy voice rhapsodized about the recent battle. It was rare for him to be so talkative, and yet not a word was said in vain. Only stingy, honest praise, some of which he also spared for the foreigners. There was also assurances that this battle was only the beginning, that they will yet give the orcs a real good beating, that they will clobber the enemy so hard they'll run straight back to the mountains with their tails between their legs. There is no fear in dying for what's right. Still, it's better not to die, and instead fight with skill, defending both yourself and your comrades. It was immediately obvious that these words did not belong to a centurion, but to a Kiliarch at the very least. The mighty veteran was used to commanding regiments of thousands of soldiers. The dwarf was not really listening to Vurius, only catching a few words of his speech. The player knew that the centurion wouldn't talk about anything secret anyway, and that the dinner wouldn't last long. That is exactly what happened. Barely an hour later, the centurion pushed himself away from the table and was the first to rise. The others followed suit. The guards began to chatter as they got up, stroking their rounded, food-filled bellies and yawning widely.
Soon, most of them will drop off to sleep.
The players jumped up in time, being not the first nor the last ones to leave the table. The main thing here was to achieve a happy medium. With a short nod, Crow thanked Vurius without approaching him. The truce between them was too fragile to risk it. The centurion paused for a moment before returning the nod. Then the players were approached by a guard responsible for maintaining stores. He took them aside, where another mountain of mismatched things lay on a spread-out piece of canvas.
"Your portion,"
explained the guard, indicating the pile. He clapped the frail cardmaster on the shoulder, then walked back to the kitchens. Having nearly buckled at the knees, Gray Mithril shook his head, rubbed his bruised shoulder, then asked,
"What do we do with all this?"
"Let's see. Everything rusted and broken, I'll take for reforging," said Crow. "Nobody would buy such things anyways, except for scrap metal dealers, and they won't give you much. On the other hand, I could really use them. That's why all the metal junk goes to me. Let's start sorting."
"Let's start,"
agreed Amal, and all three of them dived headfirst into the loot. 15 minutes later, one pile was split into three smaller ones. Two of them the dwarf gave to his friends with the following advice. "Spare a couple of scrolls to teleport to the city of Krom, which lies beside Darkwood. It's a city in a permanent state of war, so they always need armor there, especially the kind that is intended for large guys like orcs and half-orcs. Go stand somewhere beside Armory Square and shout, 'Gray Orc Trophy Gear!' and you'll sell out in no time. Before that, drop by a small shop selling weapons and see what they charge for similar equipment. Set your price a third below that. Take my pile of junk, too, to sell."
"Thanks for your advice, senor,"
squeaked Amau.
"We'll do exactly as you say."
"While you're there, try to find a couple of cards with forest giants in them," added Crow. "They're dim-witted but powerful creatures. Myth could use a few in his arsenal."
"Thank you. Any other good cards I can get there?"
inquired the cardmaster, stuffing one object after another into his backpack.
"My deck is almost empty."
"Consider black panthers and wolves from Darkwood. They're formidable monsters. But be warned, their cards are expensive. They won't be easy to get."
"We'll try our best. See you tomorrow. We'll be back early to help you with chores."
"Buy a few issues of Waldira Herald," said Crow, remembering suddenly. "And use some of my money to buy flour, millet, and smoked bacon. I also want 6 live piglets and 20 chicks, and 20 ducklings."
"Oho, I sense a farm in the making. Okay, got it. See ya."
"See you later." As he packed up the remaining junk, Crow muttered under his breath. "A farm, he says. I wish. Not in this destroyed mess. But that's okay. We'll fix it." Carefully folding the canvas cloth, the dwarf carried it back to the guards. Only then did he go back to his own plot. He unloaded his rucksack, checking that Lori had still not returned. Once more, he grabbed the smithing bellows and began to fan the flames in the hearth. Soon, his female comrade-in-arms will return, and most likely bring even more exciting news. She could barely contain her excitement before. Now, she'll simply be dying to tell him. She must have found out something interesting from Centurion Virius's past life. Chapter 2. Once upon a dark moonless night. Better, faster, stronger. Once upon a dark moonless night, in the pitch blackness of a tomb, in the darkness under a blanket, a very quiet voice whispered in secret. And that's how it all happened. Since then, having miraculously survived that awful day, Centurion Virius viciously hates all foreigners and wishes them death from the start. And since then...
"That's enough," grumbled Crow, not keeping his voice down at all. With a snap of his fingers, he lit a white magical candle, which had somehow found its way into the pile of trophy junk from the Grey Orcs. This action did not go unnoticed by Lori, who broke out into a storm of furious protests.
"What are you doing? Here I am, in the frozen darkness, telling you dark nightmarish stories from a grim black past, and you decide to light candles?"
"For a cozy atmosphere," tried to explain the dwarf. He moved the shivering flame of the candle further away from the girl, who had puffed up her cheeks. "You're finished telling the story, right?"
"I still haven't sung you the song."
"What song?"
"The one about Centurion Virius. It is sung in grim taverns at the edges of swamps, and in travelers' inns hidden beneath icy hills. But only after the 5th mug of Hell's Grog, the recipe for which, by the way, I've managed to acquire. One sip sends fire right down to your bones. The song itself, though, is horribly sad. It doesn't rhyme, but still, it's good to listen to while drinking a mug of Hell's Grog. Here, listen. An oath had the devious foreigner taken,
The courageous guard did not sense a betrayal. He led his whole army to storm Doragral. They fought like lions. They fought like tigers. The cursed dark murklings went down in droves. But even the titans of light need a break. The alarmed cry of the silver horn summoned a flash of light and opened a portal. But the oath-bound foreigner did not come, did not bring promised help. On that day, their allies did not appear.
And watching his comrades die one by one.
Stop, stop! The dwarf interrupted his girlfriend's wailing. Stop!
There's also a chorus. It goes like this. Curse you! Curse you!
I beg you, stop wailing.
Wailing? I mean, singing. All that sadness hurts my soul. I'd listen, but only after my fifth mug of Hell's Grog. Your singing is just too sad. Yeah, I know how to wail real sad. I mean, sing. You're confusing me.
We'll learn the recipe of Hell's Grog, said the dwarf firmly, ending the discussion.
He threw back the corners of his blanket and fixed the candle to the floor. Not long ago, we had a blast of cold weather, perfect for northern-style drinks. If the ingredients are simple, then we can start selling the grog to convoys and caravans as soon as tomorrow. With a quiet rustling, a huge snake slithered up to the candle. With its pea-sized brain, it evaluated the flickering flame, realized that the candle doesn't pose any danger, and slithered back into the darkness, from where soon came a strangled squeak. Mice had infested the tomb. Where did they come from? Fortunately, the snake successfully dealt with the onslaught of rodents, adding extra protein to their daily free rations of milk. Waldira is cunning. If she cannot heal over the damage, such as, for example, an underground tunnel, she will try to place inhabitants into it. Opened a tomb? Here are rats and mice for you. Dug a hole? She'll quickly add some giant centipedes to it, along with wild rice fins, carnivorous moles, and mopsars, who are so famous for their smile.
Everything was that simple, huh?
The dwarf flipped over onto his back and stared at the circle of light on the ceiling. Snuggling up to him, Baby fixed her stare on the same spot and murmured sleepily,
Uh-huh. Everything was that simple. But it's also the worst that could have happened. You remember our blue-eyed, self-declared emperor's pet saying, right? Nothing simpler than a lost cause. All right, if you don't want to listen to my singing, you can listen to my snoring instead. I'm going to sleep. No fun bedroom games today, Sir Crocher. Don't even think about it. I'm beat.
She barely finished her sentence, sinking rapidly into sleep and growing quiet at the dwarf's side.
She's beat, huh?
Snorted Crow quietly, looking at the sleeping girl with uncharacteristic tenderness in his eyes.
Sweet digital dreams, baby. Tomorrow is a brand new day.
For a long time, he gazed at Lori's face. Then he forced his thoughts back to Centurion Virius's nearly full story, whose past was truly dark and blood-chilling. Yes, indeed, simplicity was a hallmark of a lost cause. Any tangled mess of events in Waldira can be slowly unraveled and straightened out. There may be thousands of wrongs, big and small, hundreds of shades of gray and rose, buckets of blood and tears shed, but it will still be possible to fix the situation. Everything depends on how much gold, effort, and time you're willing to invest. Betrayal, however, especially one that costs the lives of so many victims. Things like that are unforgivable, and the loyal locals rarely cool down afterwards. Usually it's the reverse. With every passing year, their hatred intensifies, especially if the traitor hasn't paid in blood for his actions. And in Virius's case, nobody paid. The player who had betrayed Virius and his soldiers is still alive and well. He hasn't ditched Waldira. He is growing his wealth and connections, rubbing shoulders with the powerful of this world, and enjoying being part of their inner circle. Life is treating him well. The traitor's name is no secret. Ral Darovan. That's what he calls himself. He is a widely known player, currently part of an equally well-known clan of architects. He occupies a fairly high-ranking position with a lot of responsibilities. Crow also knew a few things about the player's chosen nickname. Long ago, Ral Darovan confessed to one of his former friends that he had always been fascinated by the fictional character Darken Ral, created by the author Terry Goodkind. To a knowledgeable person, this says a lot. Darken Ral is such a dark character, he makes even the famous Darth Vader look like an innocent little angel. When Ral was making his digital avatar upon his first entry to Waldira, the word Darken had already been taken. That's how Ral Darovan came into existence, beginning his life's journey in the magical world. All of these facts surfaced in the dwarf's mind only after a thorough digging in the long-forsaken garden of old memories. There, beneath a thin layer of barren soil, clumps of interesting info could still be found. Ral Darovan was a real nasty character, and since he did what he did, that means the reason was so compelling that Centurion Virius and his men could be readily considered small change. On the way to a gold bar, losing a few cents is hardly a problem. Everything was simple to the point of being banal. At the start of one of the northern campaigns, the Alliance of Light was incredibly successful. So successful, in fact, that it did not even notice how far back it pushed the Murklings.
The dark side was forced to withdraw into the depths of the icy valleys crisscrossed by crooked ridges and deep fissures, a land covered by eternal night.
The Murklings suffered one defeat after another as they retreated towards Doragral, the giant fortress built of meteorite rock and ice enchanted with dark magic. That's where the Murklings took refuge. They were quite shaken by their own swift and shameful retreat from the battlefield. It wasn't something that had ever happened before. The military campaign, which would have normally lasted at least several months, was over in a week. All that was left to do for the forces of light was to cast one last disdainful look at the impregnable enemy fort hidden by piercing winds that swirled clumps of frozen snow around Doragral. Then the army would have headed home, victorious, where sunlight, loving relatives, and tasty home cooking awaited them. And that was exactly what they were planning to do. They clearly did not have enough forces to storm Doragral. There was no point in staying too long in that eternal icy darkness, where one's wandering gaze kept falling on strange silhouettes that sulked at the edge of the torchlight. A third of their soldiers were sick or wounded. Their provisions of food and supplies were dwindling. The warriors were tired. It was time to go home. However, right at that fateful moment, when Centurion Virius had almost given the order, and at that time he had occupied a far higher position, several foreigners appeared at the entrance of the commander's tent. It is worth noting that the foreigners were well known and well regarded in many places. The hero Virius greeted them with a cordial embrace, sat them down at a table, and listened attentively to their message. Their proposal forced him into deep thought. The foreigners were suggesting the unthinkable, to stay beside the Murkling's fortress of Doragral and to deliver a finishing blow, to break through the defenses of the foul creatures, to burst inside and destroy the enemy, and then the fortress itself. First, they'll eliminate certain artifacts, and then, with the aid of awakened volcanic fire, they'll melt and burn down the accursed Doragral. Let nothing remain of it except for a pitiful smoking puddle. And later, not even that. Just an empty, icy plateau scoured by grim winds. The foreigner, Ral Darovan, took an oath that at the sound of the silver horn, a most powerful artifact made by the Elf King himself, he will bring over numerous great warriors and magicians who will join the fight and help Virius's army rid at least this part of Murkland, once and for all, of the Murkling filth who have infested it. Virius took a long time to think, but the foreigner Darovan knew exactly what to offer.
What sort of warrior could refuse him?
Virius was no exception.
They shook hands and sealed the deal. What happened the next day became known as the massacre of the Third Northern Campaign, which had begun so unbelievably successfully and came to such a horrifying end. The reason was simple. At the moment when Verius used the silver horn given to him, the huge portal opened and nobody came to help the fighting warriors. The horn sounded again and again. The portal opened again and again. The magic of the artifact was growing weaker. The murklings switched to attacking. Like nightmarish shadows, they rushed down the icy walls. Several hours later, Verius, now nearly out of his mind, lost half of his army. At this point, victory was out of the question. No hope remained for being rescued either. And then, throwing away the useless silver horn in fury, Verius disappeared among the ice hummocks. Echoes of his mad cries bounced off the sneering ice, and then he fell. Many people saw him vanish into a bottomless black crevice. The commander was gone. He dropped into an abyss and disappeared. The agonizingly retreating army was left without a leader. And then the soldiers fled. The howling murklings mercilessly pursued them, striking them in the back and capturing men alive by trapping them in ice crystals. It was a terrifying sight. Frozen figures inside ice, standing upright like tombstones on ice, and watching with their unmoving eyes as their comrades ran away. This was the end of everything. And that's when that happened. The blizzard hit. A wild, snowy blizzard of unprecedented strength that instantly covered everything in a shroud of white. Everything was plunged into total darkness. The torches were extinguished, all sources of light were gone, even the stars were hidden. When the skies cleared again, the surprised warriors shouted in amazement. Dora Growl disappeared. Everything changed. They were standing in a familiar place, a place that was miles and miles away. The remains of the army suddenly found themselves on the southern shores of Murkland, and right on the shoreline, a stone's throw away from the huge army camp that they had set up themselves, ships were waiting for their arrival. How? How did they manage to travel dozens of leagues in the blink of an eye? To this day, nobody knows the answer. Except for Verius himself. His huge stooped figure was standing right there with what remained of his army. The warrior was covered head to foot with mysterious and scary-looking dark green frost, which refused to melt. His face resembled a black and green mask, while his smoking eyes stared blindly into nothingness. Smoke was coming out of his eyes. Who else, if not Verius, could have managed to save the remains of the army and transport them to safety? That was how the Third Northern Campaign ended. Murklings were pushed back again, and their plans thwarted. This time, however, the amount of lives lost was catastrophic. Verius's career was destroyed, but he didn't even notice it. Nothing seemed to bother him anymore. Many people tried to guess how his army managed to survive. Everyone considered Verius a key figure, but their theories varied. Some whispered that, at the very bottom of the crevice, where the maddened centurion fell, lived ice demons, to whom Verius must have sold his soul in exchange for rescuing his men. Others have murmured that after falling into the crevice, Verius died. It was impossible to survive a fall from such height. There, at the bottom of the abyss, he must have made a deal with something or someone who possessed incredible power. This power resurrected Verius and saved the army. But the time is coming when Verius will have to pay dearly for that help. Others, who had been standing on the edge of that fateful crevice, insisted that they had seen the faint outlines of strange buildings in the darkness at the bottom. The buildings strongly resembled some sort of temple. But who in their right mind would build a temple at the bottom of a deep, icy trench, especially in Murkland and right next to the Murklings themselves? Who would be that insane? Or perhaps they were too powerful to care about Merklings and Merkland's eternal cold and darkness?
Nobody managed to find out the truth. As time passed, the whole story was forgotten. The tragedy got buried in memory. Such was the terrifying tale, which, if you were to add up all the rumors, was far from complete. To this day, Virius keeps running away from someone, or something. He literally wanders the vast lands of Voldaira, somehow managing to fulfill his duty as a guard at the same time. He defends outposts and carries out the king's orders. Moreover, Virius protects even the accursed foreigners, whom he hates from the depths of his smoking soul. Now it's obvious why he and Crow turned out to be such irreconcilable neighbors. It couldn't have been any other way. Crow is a foreigner, an eyesore, a bad reminder of the past, a thorn in his side. And Virius had tried to tear out this thorn and throw it as far away from Grey Peak as possible. But the dwarf is a real stubborn thorn. He cannot leave this place. Thus he dug his heels into the rocky soil with all his might. This is his land. He is not going anywhere.
Are his problems with Virius over?
No, that's not possible. The system level of their relations was still negative. Only by showing bravery during the fight did Crow win over a little kindness from the Centurion and create a tiny thaw in their relationship. After all, Crow did not betray Grey Peak. He did not run away to save his money or possessions. The dwarf stayed and kicked out the Grey Orcs and their little friends. He wasn't even fazed by the giant hawk moth, which had hovered over their heads like hell's vengeance. What else is known? Virius is still getting milked as clans collect weather cataclysms from him like one might pluck a cherry from the top of a free cake. Lori mentioned many clans who had done this to the poor Centurion. The last ones had been the Sleepless, who had pretended to offer help. Considering that Virius personally hates foreigners, the Sleepless clan must have used some powerful influences, such as their reputation with the guards of Algora. And that is a very strong influence. Maybe there was something else in addition to that. No matter how cold and closed off Virius seems, you can still find a key to unlocking his better side. You just need the skill. And old gaming clans have those kinds of skilled players. You'd be surprised at what they can achieve. Another interesting fact, one of those clans, who grabbed a couple of the incredibly powerful cataclysms for themselves, was the Architects. It is one of the oldest and most powerful clans. However, one of their key figures is Ral Daravan, the same one who betrayed Virius in the past, forcing him to experience unbearable grief. How did they manage it? How did they get around the Centurion's fearsome hate? Well, Ral Daravan himself certainly did not show his face here. Everything was done by his clanmates. Their clan's reputation with the guards had made an impact. There are some additional possibilities, too. Digging into it might uncover something interesting. The second obvious question, what was the reason for the betrayal? Architects present themselves exclusively as a clan of the light. In reality, it's not the truth. Some very dark things, big and small, happen behind the screen of outward decency and good intentions, but nobody sees it. Everything happens backstage, behind closed doors, and when the curtains open, all you see on stage are smiling paladins and priests of the light, courageous warriors and powerful mages, all heroes who slay howling zombies with bolts of lightning. The flowing capes and waving flags securely hide the darkness festering on the inside, the greed, lust for power, and lack of morals. All clans are this way. Otherwise, they wouldn't even break into the top 100. But Architects went as far as betrayal. The guard of Algora could have reacted very negatively. Everything could have gone to hell, as even the king himself really cares about his soldiers. The ruler of Algora's kingdom could have easily asked the simple question, "Why did you lie and not come?" And this question was likely voiced in a severe tone, like a roll of thunder. And it was likely voiced in the throne hall, probably by the king himself.
This question could not have remained unasked, and it was impossible to leave it unanswered. Impossible. The architect clan did not have the option to stay silent. Either Darovan himself or the head of the clan were obligated to respond to the summons of the Almighty King. They had to give him a clear answer regarding why they did not keep their word and did not show up to help the army dying in the land of ice. No need to think too hard about this one. It is obvious what happened. The architects humbly obeyed the summons of Algora's mighty ruler. They bowed their heads in respect and then gave a long and detailed answer. Judging by the ancient clan's continued popularity in Waldira, the answer must have fully, or almost fully, satisfied the king. Punishment was averted. Reputation was preserved. Actually, there was a drop in reputation, but it was negligible. A reduction by 1 or 2 points at most. The same happened with Algora's guards, and with those who live in the region that stretches from the southern shores of Mirkland to the Shard Archipelago. They are all connected in one way or another, since they often launch military campaigns against the accursed Mirklings. That is because Mirklings are a real threat that constantly hangs like an axe over many heads. That's why tribes of fishermen and of walrus and whale hunters and northern towns in general spare no resources and send quite a lot of men to fight them. Should the tribal chiefs get wind of the betrayal by Ral Darovan and the architect clan as a whole, that would mean another hit to their reputation. And again, the head of the clan and the offender will receive a summons from one tribe or another to come give an explanation. And yet, the Archies went ahead with the plan. They executed it so smoothly that they hardly lost anything. Crow knew this because he hadn't heard any rumors of the architects losing popularity among the regular locals of Waldira. This leads to several simple conclusions. Everything had been planned from the start. This wasn't a spontaneous act. Archies never intended to come and help. They knew about the catastrophic consequences and prepared a most convincing excuse in advance. The architects were undoubtedly pursuing some very important goal, and most likely they achieved this goal while managing to keep everything secret. Their goal was so precious to them that they even risked their reputation with the most important factions in Waldira. Among those factions was Algora's Guard, which is analogous to peacekeeping forces in Waldira, a force that is readily deployed across the world. To risk losing the goodwill of the guards of Algora. Vurius was no more than a pawn. It is clear why the Archies chose him. The former army commander and hero combined many character traits that are ideally suited for manipulation. He is a fanatical warrior who lives to battle. He hates Mirklings. Like every hero and mighty warrior, he dreams of an epic, legendary battle, and the storming of the ice fortress of Doragral fit the bill perfectly. The plan bore marks of numerous cunning spies and balding eggheads who worked for the clan day and night to develop the treacherous scheme. Everything was thought of, down to the smallest detail, and very skillfully brought to life. As for the hundreds of dead soldiers, that was collateral damage. Same goes for Vurius, who nearly lost his mind. The only thing that had likely gone against the treacherous plans for the architects was the miraculous rescue of the army remnant from the icy prison. Most likely, the architects had genuinely hoped that no survivors would escape the carnage. It is much easier to explain the situation to the king when you are the only one explaining. Crow was someone who had done many things in the past and had gained much wisdom from experience. As such, he was prepared to bet his own hill that, halfway between Doragral and the southern shores of Mirkland, numerous groups of architect fighters had hidden in the snow and ice drifts. Their job was to mercilessly eliminate the few survivors running towards the distant shore where ships awaited, except that the fugitives never appeared. The retreating soldiers were transported to the shore by an unseen powerful force. The Archies were left empty-handed,
and they were deeply surprised by the news that Virius's army was already behind them and hastily boarding onto the ships. Crow could picture the cries of amazement echoing across the plains. Nothing else was known about the Archie's plan for now. He needed to send Lori on another intelligence-gathering mission. Not on her own, though. She will be bringing a young, smiling helper along. It's time to break up the inseparable duo. The time has come for Amau to learn new, specific skills. And, at the same time, to make sure she wants this. As for Myth, Crow will deal with him personally, starting next morning. The force that had carried the huge number of soldiers and animals to the shore was definitely godlike. The power was just too strong, and most importantly, akin to that of a genie. Genie was the former name of local creatures who were capable of fulfilling fairly big requests with a single click of their fingers. Click, and your enemy is gone. Click, and here is a hole 1,000 feet deep. Click, and the dying army is saved. Waldira has many very powerful mages. However, convincing them to help is no easy task. They like to take several days or even weeks to gather their thoughts. That is the exact opposite of what happened here. When Virius fell, someone approached him. Then Virius made his request and, click, the army is saved. While the centurion is left standing beside it, brushing dark green snow off his frost-bitten mug. A rather quick reaction to a request. There was the mention of a certain temple at the bottom of the abyss-like trench in the ice. Was it some sort of holy being after all? Judging by the location, it wouldn't be a god of light. But why would the dark do good deeds? Except maybe in exchange. After all, Virius has been running away from something for a long time now. What had the centurion promised? Did he agree to do something very, very bad? So many mysteries to unravel. Again, this will be a job for Lori and Amau. Actually, he had another theory. The black-haired dwarf rubbed his forehead thoughtfully and went still again in the sleepy darkness of the converted tomb. What was happening to Virius wasn't pursuit. The dwarf was nearly certain of this. It wasn't a curse either. He had read about it before. Once, his team had to deal with something similar. They had a very hard time, and it was totally unexpected, too. At that time, their mission was very special. They equipped themselves to deal maximum damage to their non-dark opponent to withstand his blows. But suddenly, almost at the center of the sunny and warm location in the middle of the day, they ran into a squad of Hell's finest spawn. Liches, vampires, dark knights, plus a multitude of run-of-the-mill zombies and skeletons, all strengthened by the aura emitted by the liches. It was a real punch to the gut, or even a kick below the belt, with a steel-toed boot. That fight got engraved into their memories forever. But that's not the point. How was the appearance of dark creatures possible in an isolated and well-protected area? Back then, the location was known to the players as the Cave of Light under the roots of the Great Tree. It was situated in the Elven Forest, 2 steps away from the great city of Wasailroom, where the immortal Elven King rules. It was simply impossible for dark creatures to get into it, not even via regular teleportation. Crow's team knew that well, since they had the same goal, to sneak into the cave undetected and, after a brief and unavoidable clash, accomplish their handsomely paid mission. The task was hardly trivial. But they managed to get past the infiltration stage. The dark creatures did too. Naturally, their team got curious, and after receiving honors at the palace of the Elf King, began to dig deeper into the matter. As for the honors, they received them for the protection of the Great Tree from the Dark Invaders. They had to fight for their lives. They ended up battling the Dark Creatures. As the Elves came running, they saw brave foreigners with strange expressions on their faces, finishing off the last wailing lich. Had those pointy-eared guys known the real reason why the strangely equipped foreigners were there? By the way, they did get asked about it by a smarmy elf with a clever, high-cheekboned face who strongly resembled an employee of Magical Government Security Service. But they managed to wriggle themselves out. As they began to investigate what happened, they unearthed a surprising amount of information. The sole purpose of the dark forces in Waldira is to conquer and destroy everything that belongs to the light. But just try to crawl out of your dark ditch when there are knights in white capes standing above you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.